This is something that we use in Paytm a lot. This is a business rule engine. This is it helps keep pace with managers and business ops. How? I mean, these are the use cases. Like, we are suddenly asked to stop sale in some UP town for, things which are priced for more than 5,000. This is just for 2 hours. And we get a call that Bangalore has having these protests, so we delay all the shipments for 2 days. We get these cases where the products greater than 5,000 rupees and originating from the states other than Jammu and Kashmir cannot be delivered in Jammu and Kashmir. So I mean, how do you handle cases like these? How we can't do deployments every now and then. We can't put up lookup tables. We don't know what to do. We can't roll out hot fixes every 5 minutes. So what we do is something which you can see right here. We have something called these kind of rules. Now, what are these rules? These rules are nothing but if conditions. The conditions are like this. For example, this is a key. If this key is greater than zero and this key is less than 10,000 and this is in this range, so and so, then we simply set a variable. I mean, how does that help us? This one? Better? Okay. So let me explain a sample rule by opening a terminal. Where's my terminal? Okay. Here. So for example, this is my a simple JavaScript object, right? And this has like these two, three keys. Now, this is a simple business rule which says that this key has to be greater than zero, this key has to be less than whatever, and this key has to be in this range, this date has to be in this range. All of these conditions, if they are and, or you can put or you can put this long conditions, then implement this action, which is just implement, just set a variable called one. Now, how does this help me? This helps when I say this. For example, this is a screenshot of my live panel, which says that the destination state is not Jammu and Kashmir and the source is Jammu and Kashmir, then I do not ship. Simple. It's very, very simple. It's very, very effective. And this saves a lot of deployments for me. So, I mean, that's it. You can put tags, you can put caching, you can priority, you can do prioritize, you can do a lot of things. So that's pretty much it. Thank you. Yeah, please. I can hear you. Yeah, I've open sourced it. I have open sourced it. So please check it out and let me know. The GUI is also there. And a couple of companies I know use it. It's obviously not as fast as the native JS, obviously. So that's not the debate. But it helps with the dynamic requirements.
Thank you, Shrey. Next speaker is Hemant. Is he here? Okay, who's the one after that? Okay, cool. Is Shovik here? Okay, next is Shreya Satish.
Hello, yeah? No, I don't have any slides. Right, time starts now. Hey guys. Time starts now? Okay, cool. Hey guys, I'm Shreyas and I work at HasGeek. I build products. If you have booked tickets on our site, I may have had a hand in that. So I want to talk about how we go about learning new things. Okay? Just a few questions. How many of you have learned or tried learning a new language or a new library this year? Yes? Wow, we have an awesome audience. How many of you have started a new project this year from scratch? Okay, awesome. How many of you have started a new project with a new tech stack? Okay, interesting. So how is your experience, just in a word? Frustrating, exciting? Not combination. Combination of both? Okay, so I just want to talk about my experience with this third case I talked about building a new product and using a new tech stack, and something I learned from that experience, and I hope you find it useful. So I just want to take you back to 2013. I was working at a startup and high on Paul Graham essays, and one day I decided to quit my job to start my own thing. And I thought I'll make a site for music teachers to teach music. Right? As a geek, what is the first thing that comes to mind when you decide to build a new product? Exactly, the tech stack. Oh, there's Haskell, there's Clojure, there's all these fancy frameworks. What am I going to use? And I spent a week trying to decide the perfect tech stack for my product because this has to be done really awesome. And I picked a new tech stack, which I knew nothing about, rolled my sleeves, and 10 days down the line, I had made zero progress on the product. Right? And how many of you have been here? Okay, great. So we're on the same page. So let's step back here, right? What's 2013 me doing there? Clearly, that's a naive approach. And when I stepped back and looked at it, I realized I was conflating two things here. Okay? When we are building a new product, what are we trying to learn? We're trying to learn what our customers want. We're trying to learn what the market needs are. We're trying to learn who our competitors are, and so on. This is very different from the technology stack, right? And when we're learning a new technology stack, what are we trying to learn? We're trying to learn patterns. We're trying to learn what are the big ideas in this library. Oh, there's unidirectional data flow. Oh, there's isomorphic rendering, whatever it is. We're trying to learn the big ideas. We're trying to understand what are the possibilities of this piece of technology, what are its limitations, and where does this make sense to use, right? So these are two very different set of learning tasks that we have in front of us, right? When building a product, we're trying to learn about our customers and the problem domain. When we're trying to learn new tech, we're trying to understand the tech itself and not the problem domain. And I try to recollect whenever I had the few successful experiences I have had when I have shipped a product or when I'm learning new tech. And the one pattern that emerged was when building new products, I've almost always used boring technology. Which basically means technology I've been very familiar with, right? So I'm familiar with Python and Ruby and JavaScript and whatever. And using familiar tech lets you focus on the problem domain. You're not scratching your head about how a directive works or how scope works in Angular or whatever. You're trying to understand the problem domain. And that is the most important thing when you're building a new product. And whereas whenever I'm learning a new tech, the most important thing is to pick an easy problem. A problem that you're familiar with, like a to-do list or an e-commerce app. Maybe you've built an e-commerce app before. Makes sense to build another e-commerce app with this new piece of technology. Make sense? This is what I sort of learned, and I just thought I'll share it with you. I'm really curious about what other approach you guys have figured out, and I'd love to talk to you about it outside. That's it. Thanks.
I don't see the light. Okay, awesome. All right, great. So I'm going to talk about developer tools again, right? And we talked about performance of user interfaces. Performance of our own developer tools is also something that I kind of care about, like have recently started caring about, right? How many of you use Travis CI or any kind of CI? Just a raise of hands. Really? Okay. Decent enough. Okay. So I'm going to talk about how do you get faster builds with Travis CI, right? So Travis CI is this tiny little thing. Basically, you'll have some test cases, you'll have some validation that you want to run on your code, right? And you want to basically get this on your pull request, like yellow, like checks running, and when they pass, you hit merge, right? Now, every time I write some code, right, and I raise a pull request, I see this, right? And my internal, I get an itch of hitting that merge button, right? Now I'm done, I've tested it myself, I want to hit merge, right? But I have to wait for all my checks to go green, and then I can say, okay, let's merge, right? This is a repo that we have inside Practo. So I wanted to focus on that elapsed time. This is the time it used to take, right? 4 minutes, 13 seconds for my itchy little brain to wait to hit that button, right? It was driving me crazy. So I'm going to talk about some tiny three tips that you can do with your Travis builds to make them super fast. First of all, don't use sudo. If you're doing anything on your setup that requires sudo, find another way, please, right? So when you're not using sudo, what Travis gives you now is it's container-based infrastructure, right? So it stores your things into Docker-like images. So your builds are super fast because it just spins that up. There's no Git clone, all of that setup, right? Your build starts pretty fast. And what you also get in their new infrastructure is dedicated cores and more RAM. Right? So it's just if you have more process power, your tests will run faster, basically. Right? Got it down to 2 minutes 45. Patrick is still not happy, but we're getting there. Right? Next thing. So another thing Travis has, which I use in some projects, which is I want to test on multiple node versions. Right? So this is useful when you're making NPM modules because you don't know where they're going to land up. Right? So I test. And what Travis gives us is pretty cool that you can have three parallel builds. Right? Which is running on three different node versions, and this is parallelized. So that is pretty cool. Another tiny hack, which is pro tip two, is you can treat it the same way by giving three environment variables, right? So I say that test suite is my environment variable, and I say integration/appointments, integration/prescriptions, right? So these are my three different test suites. And because I've defined them as environments, now I can run these as three different, even though they're the same thing, right? They're the same code base, same environment, but I can run them in parallel. So this is a pretty cool hack that I had. Parallel suits, right? Got it even faster, 1 minute, 36 seconds, right? Last tip, tip number three, is cache your dependencies. So Travis gives you a way of caching your dependencies. You can cache node modules, var components, just tell it the directory. And when something, like when your package.json changes, it will just install the diff, right? Basic cache, right? So if you cache all your dependencies, it's even faster. It got it down to 47 seconds, right? Which is super cool for Patrick, right? If you're using Travis CI or if you're using any other CI, these three things actually hold true for all CIs, even if you're using Jenkins or Circle. Containerize, cache everything you can, and try to make it as parallel as possible, right? If you have any more tricks, I kind of am stuck at 47. I can't bring it better. If you have any tips, catch me on my Twitter or talk to me outside. Thank you.
Next up, Amit Kapoor.
Hello. Which one? Yeah.
Okay, how many of you use Markdown? Okay, as developers, I'm guessing a fair bit. And how many of you would like to do visualization using Markdown? Right. Okay, a few hands. Okay, great. So in the morning, there was a talk by Kuran, and he talked about a lot of the libraries that are there to do visualization. And one of the hardest things about doing visualization is if you want to learn something like D3, for example, it's very imperative. You have to describe what it does. There are a number of abstractions on top of that which help you write it simpler, and one of them is VegaLite, which has a grammar of graphics built into it, or a grammar of interactive graphics soon come in VegaLite. So this is just a implementation which we just did right now in JSFoo. So it's a hack done in JSFoo and with Shreyas and Vidya. So D has Geek Guys helped me kind of put this together. The idea is basically you write Markdown as usual, and you have a code block on the left. And you write your code with simple three backticks, like you would write code, and instead of any language, you just say it's Viz, so V-I-S. And then you just give a very basic specification, which is data. In this case, there's a data set we're using, which is cars.csv. We're using describing anything through point, and we want x and y to show. And x in this case is kilometers per liter, and y is price. So this is a price versus kilometer per liter for all cars in India under about 10 lakhs. And you just give the spec, and you have a chart that you have that comes to the right. Very simple, you just write the visualization in Markdown. And you could do something more complex and describe much more, and you could get more like a bubble chart with fix everything. In this case, I guess you can write. Yeah, this is much better. With four variables, in this case, price and kilometer per liter and Y and X, type, which is hatchback and sedan, and horsepower as the size of the circle. Right, so you just write specification on the left, and you can get it to the right. You can use it for blogging. You can use it in part of your documentation. It just, the tech it uses YAML, converts it into JSON, which converts it into VegaLite, which is the specification on the right. That's it. Thank you so much. And it's available at vizdown.amitcaps.com if you want to know. I just tweeted it out, and the code is on GitHub.
Okay. Is Subir here?
All good. Awesome. I don't have any notes. I don't see anything. Okay. Hello everyone, the theme for this JSFoo is performance and speed, and what better way to cap it off than speaking about assembly. Well, a couple of years ago, the mention of assembly would have been frowned upon in a conference about JavaScript. How times have changed, haven't they? I think JavaScript started off as a language
which solved critical features like pointer trails, mouse pointer trails, revenue impacting stuff like popping up advertisements. But we have come a long way since then. Over the last decade or so, especially, we have pushed JavaScript to its very limits, and we always need more performance and more speed. We came up with something called ASM.js a while back, which is, strictly speaking, a subset of JavaScript. It's kind of an optimized instruction set, but again, it is JavaScript. It's not a new language, it's just a subset, and it performs really well. If you compare it to native code, it gets as close as 2x, only 2x slower than native performance. And it's a text format, so you can actually hand code ASM.js, though I wouldn't recommend it. But if you really want to debug or test something or view the source in ASM.js, that's possible. But again, we hit the ceiling with ASM.js again. In June 2015, a W3C WebAssembly group was created. And the participants included Google, Microsoft, Apple, and Mozilla, among others. They proposed a standard called WebAssembly or WASP. And their aim was to build a compile, a native compile format for the web browser. Now, strictly speaking, this will be a native compile format for JavaScript engines. So it may, in future, work outside the browser as well. But the target for now is the browser. Now, the design docs and code is all on GitHub. I hope this is visible. Yeah. And WASM is supposed to be an open standard, unlike plugin extensions like Silverlight and Flash. The main problem with which was they were closed, and they were in an entirely different code base from the, your basic JavaScript engine. So this is very unlike Silverlight or Flash, and it's going to be completely open source. So obligatory Flash bashing check. And it's going to be native speed, so it will be up to 2 times faster than ASM.js. And experiments have shown that it can run as fast as 20 times faster than plain JavaScript. One concern with Flash and similar platforms was safety. Now, WASM is something which is built, which is being built to be inherently safe. It has checks for same origin policies and memory leak checks, so you won't be able to do anything outside the sandbox environment of your V8 engine. And let me clarify about the term native here. When you speak of, when you hear the word native, you think it's something to do with which is running directly on your hardware. Now, this doesn't exactly mean you're running, you're directly accessing the bare metal. This is native format for your V8 engine, which already is within a sandbox. So this doesn't mean you will have access to different hardware or proprietary APIs. It's up to the implementation to provide them, but the standard says you must maintain portability across different hardware platforms. Now, what we may use this for, there the possibilities are endless. Off the top of my head, I can think of games, augmented and virtual reality applications, scientific simulations, CAD, 3D designing. Any Blender users in the house? I mean, not in the kitchen. Here, we have one, okay. So if you are into 3D development or game engine programming, this can be a very good use case for using WebAssembly. Now, the fun part is, it's been barely a year since this proposal was initiated, but you can use WebAssembly today in your browser. The latest browsers, Chrome and Firefox, and surprisingly, Microsoft Edge support WebAssembly. They have experimental support. And yeah, Microsoft Edge, you heard it right. So obligatory snide remark about Internet Explorer / Microsoft, check. Now, WASM has a shell called Binarian, which is again on GitHub. You can clone the repo and build your own Binarian binaries. Now, a fun fact here for the Game of Thrones lovers, Binarian is actually supposed to rhyme with Targaryen. And the tagline for Binarian is code and bugs. The house words of Targaryen, if I remember correctly, are fire and blood. Okay, obligatory GOT comment, check. Now the two binaries provided by Binarian are ASM to WASM, which compiles ASM.js into WASM text format. and the WASM AS compiles the text format to a WASM binary. An important point which I missed was WASM is not just a binary format, but it has a compatible text format which is human readable and editable as well. Let me quickly jump into a code demo. Is this readable enough? Okay. Now this is something I wrote in ASM.js. This is a fairly complicated maths library. It gives you the square of an integer. And I'm calling it out from here. Basically what it does is it produces the square of the number and it echoes onto the console the function as well as the result. Let's see the result here. After all the React and UI stuff, I was able to build this. Fairly complicated UI. Trust me, I am a front-end engineer. So I have two versions, one using ASM.js and one using WASM. This is the function, and this is the output. Now, watch when I click on WASM. You see this part, this is native code. Now, this is where all the difference comes in. Now, of course, we can benchmark this and find out the difference in performance, but that's out beyond the scope of this talk. Let's go back here. Absolutely. Yeah. This is the ASM.js code. This is the readable text format of WASM, which is WASD. And this is the binary format. And to cap it off, we have a playable demo, which was built by the WASM team, which you can watch me trying to play and struggle. Okay, but this is a proof of concept that WASM works and works as of now, as of today. This is just a Chrome version 53, and let me see. About flags, is it? Yeah. Yeah, this is the flag which you'll have to enable if you want to try this out. So that's it. All this code, this complicated code, is on my GitHub if you are willing to fork it and make it even more awesome. And I'm available on Twitter, not very active, but if you would like to drop me a message, please feel free to do so. And if you are building anything using WASM, I would like to know. Thank you very much.
Dhaval. Okay.
Hello. Okay. Okay. How many guys are you using GraphQL or like? Sorry. So this talk is more about why to shift to GraphQL or why to invest into GraphQL. So I'm going to focus on that. Not too about how to use it. So first of all, this is in our REST scenario. Normally we make some request and this is some familiar, like this is some REST API where we are hitting a user and we are requesting user by its ID. And our server will resolve that request and it sends back us like some JSON or something like that. Now, if you decide to let's change something in our view or let's add new feature to users, so what we do? We create some new versioning in our API or we pass some parameters after the APIs. And it will send us new users, like the new version of the user. So basically, we are going to duplicate our old code for this part. Like we are going to duplicate the entire code operation which is happening into the user API. That's the one point. That's the first point. Then let's say we are making a request and that request returns some sort of JSON and that JSON contains some sort of more keys or more arguments which we are going to pass again with like here I'm passing the like hitting the events and I'm getting the events by ID, so the event has ID, name and location and there is an attendees field, so attendee has an array of user IDs and those user ID again, if you want to load all the user ID who is going to attend that event, we are going to hit multiple requests to the server and it's like we are going to make multiple round trips, and if you are in a like mobile network the round trip are really like costly. So this is the second point. This is how GraphQL looks like, and in the both of the scenario, the first and second, we are actually tightly couple our views with our models on the server. So whenever we want to change something into our views, we are like have to specifically change something into our like server side code. And here I am making a request to the my GraphQL server, and this is what request looks like. Like I am specifying the user and I am specifying the fields that I want to display on that view. And it is going to return me the exact thing that I requested. Like I need just a username and city, nothing else, nothing more. Now I'm making the second request. At that time, I'm in this request, I'm adding a email also, and server is going to give me email into my view. So how GraphQL works and what it is actually. There is a misconception like the GraphQL, if you want, like it's like a query language, like it works with the graph databases, or it's like GraphQL, it's like another query language like SQL or something like that. But GraphQL, it's just like a set of specs which is you can implement with any code base or any storage engine. So basically, there is a data source and there is a data source. You can put your GraphQL server onto any data source, and whenever you make some request, it goes through the GraphQL server and it fetches the same data. So if we break down the GraphQL into furthermore, so there is a GraphQL core. Okay, I have very less time. Let's fast. GraphQL core, type system and application code. So application code is like where you are making operations, like where you are interacting with your data source, and type system is where you define that what you actually want to fetch or like what is the that object would look like. And core is like managing all the stuff which has all the APIs which you are which we can use. So this is what type definition looks like in the GraphQL. In that I'm just going to give you a real quick demo, very fast. So basically, this is GraphQL, which is also created by like the guys who created, I mean, Facebook. So it is GUI for making a graph queries, If you see here, so there is a root object called movies, and I'm just asking for IDs, and it's going to give me the IDs. Now, if I add, I have also title field. So if I give something like title, so it's going to return the title. So right now, there's like no tightly coupled thing between our views and our server. And if you add, like if you remove the stuff like this, like, so it's like what you are requesting, that's only, just a second, that's the thing you are going to get. So there is no overfetching, there is no underfetching, and it's going to really improve the, like, it's really going to improve the performance. Okay, thank you. If you like really want to see something else, just meet me. Great.
Check. Hello. So yesterday also I gave one of the class talk, and I was little nervous yesterday as it was my first talk, and today I'm feeling little better. So how many of you have used Socket IO? Awesome. So okay, I'm gonna talk about my experience and like the problems I got into while I was using Socket IO for one of my, you know, like yesterday I did mention about the Ray calendar, right? So to, instead of polling, so we were using Socket IO to, you know, in order to get the appointments, while two or three receptionists are, you know, like adding or deleting the appointments at the same time. So yeah, as most of you are aware of, whenever you initiate a like connection request from your browser to a Socket server, it generally uses a transport card polling, and then if the browser supports, and then if your Nginx is replying back and like sending the header saying upgrade, then it will upgrade to WebSocket. With that, since, you know, like we had thousands of practices which used to get connected to Socket server, it used to, you know, like throw a HTTP error with the response code saying 400, like it's a bad request, right? So generally, each polling HTTP request will have a Socket ID along with a timestamp, and whenever it gets disconnected, it will keep on polling. It will keep on trying to reconnect again and again. So with that, I used to have around 5 to 6% of error rates during the peak time. And sure. So I actually, cool. I'll just hide this. I'll close it. Okay, so when we had, during the peak hours, I used to have 4 to 5% of error rates. And then a response time, as usual, it used to be around somewhere around 120 milliseconds. And like we just debugged it for 2 to 3 weeks, and then we realized some of the browsers which will never get upgraded to WebSocket from the polling transport because of the outdated versions. Like some of the doctors, they never used to upgrade their web browsers, right? Yeah, that's not their job. So, and then I kind of thought of this way. So instead of trying to connect to, trying with the transport called polling, let me try with the transport called WebSocket. Because if you look at support for WebSockets in all the browsers, right? So most of our browsers supports WebSockets. And then I did this way. So I first try with the WebSocket. If the browser don't support, then I fall back to polling. With that, I could achieve. So yeah, August 10th is the time when I actually did this hack, and since then I pretty much had 0% of errors. So I never had errors, and then kind of there would be some one or two errors. So I'll go to a detailed view. Okay, so if you see some of the errors which happens now and then, right? So those are the requests which made from the old versions of browsers which don't have support for WebSockets. Cool, that's it.
Supreet here? The last speaker is Vamsi.
Hello?
Hi everybody, this is Vamsi, a backend developer from Practo. So how many backend developers are here? I don't see many people. I'm not feeling left out right now. So I'll tell you a funny story. We went to a recent hackathon, okay, and our team consisted of four people, three backend developers and one Android developer. So three backend developers. I mean, we didn't have a front-end developer. So we went there, we built a calling service. I'll tell you an example of it. So if a startup like, let's say, example of Zoomcar, it wants to enter a tier 2 city where it's not there. So it comes to us and says, I have four questions. Please get the answers from the users in Mysore or some other city. So we give our service as a calling service, to the user. So user will call us, give a missed call, and then we call him back and then ask the four questions. So user gets recharged for answering questions. His mobile will be recharged for that. So everything was done. Our hackathon project was completed. So then we had to realize that company needs to see somehow how many users have called, what was their answer, etc. That's when we realized that we actually needed a front-end developer. And then, so we had to build some dashboard where we can do that. So essentially, we just needed some charts where we can display some statistics. So by just Googling and etc., we happened to build this. Probably, I don't know if it's good or not, but I'm really proud that we actually, managed to build this. I spent, 5 or 6 hours. In that 5.5 hours, I was just searching on the internet for a ready-made code. So I was I am a backend developer. So after that, we managed to build this. So it's really interesting, I must say, because I just had to search and write some very small lines of code to complete this. So this is d3.js. So these are the questions. I really love this part. I know you guys are front-end developers and this is not a big thing for you. I love the way it changes. Whoosh. I like that. So all I had to do was write this much code, which says pick up my margin, pick up my width, height, and select a div from HTML. I wrote the HTML too, by the way. So, and give my scale, that is ordinal or linear. Ordinal is just, it says that fixed, like this, they're fixed. Hatchback, sedan, and SUV, and these are scales which can, there is something between 7 and 6. So this is the difference. It's linear. This is the y-axis is linear and x-axis is ordinal. So once I define the scale, I just have to draw and then use this SVG element and then use translate. So I give the x and y coordinates to translate, and that's how I happen to achieve this part. This, and then we managed to also get the code of PyChart. I didn't write the whole code. I got the code and I managed to put my data into it and modify it according to my needs. Thank you. That's it.
So we have one more speaker who was supposed to be the second speaker. This is Hemant. He was downstairs running the BOF.
Yeah, sorry guys, like I was downstairs doing the Birds of Feather for Progressive Web Apps. I feel lucky enough to see a couple of, at least decent number of people here. And, yeah. Wait, it's async await. Yeah, so how many of you have heard this feature called async await? Apart from you guys, like I can speak anything, I guess. Just kidding. So I want to talk about this blog post I wrote about like in 2015. A simple use case, I wrote a node module called XKCD images. The whole purpose of this node module is to fetch a random XKCD image. How many of you XKCD? Like I've just got like 4 minutes anyways. Like, yeah, it doesn't matter. XKCD is that cartoon thingy, which explains complex comp science and science. So if you see this, should I bump up my fonts or is it fine? Okay. Yeah, I don't see my flux. Yeah. So I require XKCD module as I do for any node module, and then I call XKCD.image. I get a callback with error and result, as normally the node style of callback with error and result. If there is anything in the result, like I would just print the result, and the result would be the random image from XKCD. Nothing high fundi about this. This is the normal kind of a node callback style pattern which most of us would have used. And we saw that it did return something. Then, like, there came an era of promisifying things. Like, you promisify this module. Promisify is this simple module that makes this callback a promise. So most of us are aware of promise, right? It's like a function that resolves to a value later somewhere in the timeline of the execution, right? So I make a promise out of this, and then you see the magic keyword here called await. So that is the async await spec which gives this await keyword. So you could do an await on a promise, and I'm console logging await XKCD. I'm not doing XKCD.then function where, and then .catch and catch, like how would you normally resolve a promise. I'm just saying await, and you saw that the result was an object which had an image in it, as before, as the previous one also had, right? So if you see at the if you have a look at the XKCD images module, it is nothing but it's using the request module and doing an request to this URL, which returns a callback with error, response, and body, right? And if the response status code is 200, that means it's okay, everything is fine. We will have the body. The body contains the JSON, which has the image info and the image URL, right? Now, if I make this entire thing a promisified request, that's what I'm doing here, like request promisify, and then pass in the URL, that returns me a promise. That's like your fetch API that what we use today. And if I run the code, I'm doing a JSON.parse await of the promise, right? So the what I feel is 2017 would be the year where we would write JavaScript like sync, but it will run like async. All our async code will look like sync. Like it just look like sync, right? If you see this, you don't see any callback or anything, right? But it runs like async. That's what I feel 2017 would be. So there is this fetch for node. Rather, I would replace this with isomorphic fetch. So fetch for node basically fetches and returns a promise. So what I'm doing is I'm saying await, and fetch has this wonderful API called .json that would do the passing for me. So I would say await fetch, which gives me my promise, and then I would say await that promise .json. So finally, I would get the result. So let us like take this as JSON. I have like 1 minute left, and I will like console log JSON. So I run this, and it's hitting the server. Yeah, so we got the result. We got some Wikipedia virus info. So basically, we reduced the entire module to a single line, which looks like sync but runs like async. So I have await fetch URL.json. So to prove it that it runs like async, I would do a console log, say meow here, right? And then run this again. I got meow, and then I got the URL. If you could notice, it is asynchronous in behavior, but looked like synchronous when you read the line. So this is async await, but so far, if you notice, I've just been talking about await. There's this simple example I would like to give on how async would work. Like, so you would write a normal function as if you would write it in any means, like just a function, but add an async keyword at the beginning of it saying that this is an async function. That means you would use await somewhere within the function. So you're using await here. This is LiFS, one of the modules I wrote, that is a FS wrapped around with promise, like promisified FS. And then you would fs.redirect that, and you would say await. So your list would have all the contents of the directory in tilde slash, right? So that is a quick demo of async await in 5 minutes. And this is how ES2017 would look like. And if you want to know more such features of what would ES Next look like, you can just go to git.io/ES Next. And we have all the stage 1, 0, 4, 5, all the proposals, 0 to 4 stages, all the proposals are there. And if you want to know the features of ES6 and ES7, as this is a progressive web app, so you could just hit JSFeatures.in and add this to your home screen, and you have ES6, ES7, and you could just link this, and you could share this link to your, say, suppose you want to show classes to somebody, it's like linkable, you can give it to them, and it's a progressive web app, so I'd advise you to add it to your home screen. That's it. Thank you, guys.